Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here this evening. What we want to do in the next 35 minutes or so is talk to you about the future of work. And in particular, we want to do seven things with you. First, I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of some of the ideas, the history of robots and the history of automation anxiety, people worrying about technology taking on their work. I'm then going to talk a little about blue-collar work. I think many people are comfortable with the idea that technology might displace some of the work done by blue-collar workers. And then I want to raise the question, the question mark in brackets there, about whether or not white-collar work is also susceptible to the sorts of changes that we're talking about. I'll then hand over, and you'll hear a little on technology, and one technology in particular, which is artificial intelligence. And then back to me to talk about white-collar work again, and finally to close on the implications of what this means. So first, the history. What's interesting is that the idea of robots, it's a very old one. Homer of the ancient rather than the Simpson variety wrote in book 18 of the Iliad, great Greek work, about driverless three-legged tripods. He talked about the house of Hephaestus, where someone went in and he was fashioning tripods, 20 in all, to stand around the wall of his well-built hall, and golden wheels had he set beneath the base of each, that of themselves they might enter the gathering of the gods at his wish and again return to his house, a wonder to behold. It's also quite interesting, the ancient Jewish mystics and sages were said to craft small sculptures out of clay called golem. And they brought them to life, it was said, to carry out various tasks and activities for them. I think the most famous story that's told is of a rabbi, Rabbi Judah Lowe. He's a 16th century rabbi in Prague. And at the time, the Jews were being subjected to expulsion and persecution. And the rabbi created a golem who he called Yosef. And Yosef was designed to defend the Prague community from attack. And the rumor is that in the synagogue still today, buried somewhere, some of the deactivated parts of these golem. Leonardo da Vinci, 15th, 16th century, he designed a driverless cart where you would play around with various cogs and let it loose and it would turn on cue. He also designed an autonomous lion that would rear up on its hind legs and various compartments would open autonomously. He also, in 1950, it was discovered, designed a humanoid robot as well, and it was recreated recently in Berlin. The word robot itself actually didn't come about until the 1920s. Karel Čapek, who was a Czech writer, introduced the term in a play, a science fiction play, RUR, the word robota coming from the Czech word meaning slavery or drudgery. Not only the idea of robots, not only did they have quite a rich history, but also the idea that we might worry about losing work to technology. So Aristotle in the Politics asked the question, for suppose that every tool we had could perform its task, either at our bidding or itself perceiving the need, then master craftsmen would have no need of servants nor masters of slaves. He was asking the question whether or not these technologies might displace slaves who were doing routine work. There's then, of course, as some people will be familiar, the stories of the Luddites in the 19th century here in Britain. They took their name from their declared support for Ned Ludd, who was an East Midlands weaver. He smashed a set of framing machines in anger and fear at the start of the Industrial Revolution. It was interesting, in 1812, machine breaking became a crime punishable by death. The act was called the Destruction of Stocking Frames, etc. Act, 1812. And the following year, several people were put to death under this act. And it was then repealed a few years later. 1930s, some of you might be familiar with an essay that John Maynard Keynes, the great British economist, wrote called Economic Possibilities for Our Grandchildren. Here he invented the term, or coined the term, technological unemployment. And he defined this as unemployment due to our discovery of means of economizing the use of labor, outrunning the pace at which we can find new uses for that labor. And I think a year later, Einstein, in a lecture, 1931, talked about industrial technologies that were meant to serve the world's progress by liberating mankind from the slavery of labor, but now they appeared ready to overwhelm their creators. This continued through the 20th century. So in the 1960s, JFK, in a news conference, 1962 in fact, regarded, and I quote, the major domestic challenge really of the 1960s to maintain full employment at a time when automation, of course, is replacing men. And then today, this is Google Trends on the word automation. It's as popular as it's been in the past 5 years. It's right up there at 100, 25% as popular a term, search term, as it was 5 years ago. So the idea of robots, the idea of automation anxiety, these aren't new things. They've been with us for a while. And I think many people are comfortable and familiar with the idea that technology might perform, might take on blue-collar work. So 1900, work of David Autor, an American economist, points out that about 41% of the US workforce was employed in agriculture. 2000 was about 2%. The output of the agricultural sector vastly greater, but the proportion of the US labor force that employed vastly smaller. The same is true in US manufacturing, past 30, 40 years. This is from the Financial Times, real output soaring, but employment in absolute terms actually falling. And you'll hear explanations that this is the sort of thing might be because of China. It's not because of China, it's because of technology. 5.6 million jobs roughly lost in US manufacturing in the first decade of the 21st century. There's estimates that up to 85% of them are due to increases in productivity, technological progress, the fact we can produce more output with fewer people. And so the question then comes, and this is where our work began, is this necessarily just a blue-collar story? Does this not also apply to white-collar work? And to answer this question, you have to ask, I think, a prior question, which is why do we think blue-collar work is uniquely susceptible to automation? And the answer to that generally is something like this, which is that work is routine. You know, it's routine work. It's procedure-based, it's process-based, it's easy to articulate the various steps that you go through in performing it, but white-collar work is very different. It's the sort of thing that requires creativity, the sort of thing that requires judgment, the sort of thing that requires empathy. White-collar work involves non-routine work, and non-routine work simply is the sort of stuff that we can't automate. And this, is, as I said, was the starting point for our book. When we began the book in 2010, we were trying to understand what technology was doing to professionals, to white-collar workers, to lawyers, doctors, and teachers, accountants, and so on. And in the book, there's hundreds of case studies. I just want now to run you through some of them to give you a flavor of the sorts of thing that we were trying to make sense of. So in education, more people signed up for Harvard's online courses in a single year than attended the actual university in its entire existence up until that point. Google DeepMind, a system designed, in fact, by a group of researchers at UCL in London, designed to play Go, a game said to be an incredibly complicated game, said there's more moves in it than there are atoms in the universe. And most people in artificial intelligence even recently thought we were about a decade away from ever building a system that could outperform a leading Go champion. But in March of last year, DeepMind sat down with Lee Sedol, who at the time was probably the best living Go champion, and beat him 4-1. Now, what's interesting about this is that Google, of course, didn't go into this to win board games. And you know, they've teamed up with Moorfields Eye Hospital, for example. And they're now using a similar system to help diagnose and treat various types of eye problems. In the world of journalism, Associated Press in 2014, they started to use algorithms to computerize the production of their earnings reports. So using these algorithms, they produce now about 15 times as many earnings reports as when they relied upon traditional print journalists alone. In the legal world, on eBay, every single year, 60 million disputes arise. 60 million. And they're resolved online without any traditional lawyers using what's called an e-mediation platform. So just bear in mind, 60 million disputes. That's 40 times the number of civil claims that are filed in the entire English and Welsh justice system. 40 times the number. They're resolved on this one website every year without any traditional lawyers. JP Morgan in the last few weeks announced the development of software called COIN, short for Contract Intelligence. It scans and interprets commercial loan agreements. COIN does in a few seconds what would traditionally take is estimated 360,000 hours of traditional legal time. Best-known legal brand in the United States isn't a traditional law firm anymore, it's LegalZoom.com, an online document drafting and legal advice platform. In the world of tax, 2014, 48 million Americans used online tax preparation software rather than a traditional tax accountant to help them. The world of audit, the traditional way in which we do an audit, huge number of financial transactions, we can't review them all, so we take a small sample, we hope that sample is representative, and we have various methods for making sure that it is, and we extrapolate. And from this small sample, we tell a story about the broader population of financial transactions. The latest wave of systems, Halo at PwC is one example. They don't just take a few samples, few data points and human beings, pour through them. Instead, they're now running algorithms through all the financial transactions, moving away from that representative sample approach. IBM Watson, it's a supercomputer that we'll talk a little more about later. What's interesting is that it's now being used again in the professions. This is a story on the BBC a few weeks ago. Japanese insurance firm Fukoko Mutual Life Insurance using this system to calculate various types of insurance premium payout. In the world of architecture, Gematsu and Koller used a swarm of autonomous flying robots to build this structure out of 1,500 bricks. Dutch website, We Build Homes. Architects go onto this website and they have at their disposal a set of digital building blocks. And they build buildings out of these digital building blocks, and then people looking for a home scroll through the various options that an architect has assembled. They click on one and it gets delivered to them, and it's assembled accordingly. This is a very interesting, again in architecture, it's the new LB Phil. Philharmonie in Hamburg, the new concert hall, 10,000 acoustic fiber panels. This was designed algorithmically. It was a generative design process. A set of design criteria was set out, the number of people that had to be accommodated, the type of materials that had to be used, even really specific things like if there was a panel within reach of somebody in the audience, it had to have a particular texture. But these criteria were set for the system, and then it generated a set of designs without using a traditional designer, and the architect could then select between them. One of the professions we looked at in our work was the clergy. We looked at divinity, and this is, I think, my favorite example. In 2011, the Catholic Church issued the first ever imprimatur, the first ever digital imprimatur, I should say. And an imprimatur is the official license granted by the Catholic Church. It issued it to this app called Confession, which helps you prepare for confession. So it's got tools for tracking sin, and it's got various drop-down panels of options for contrition. And yeah, you laugh, but it was incredibly controversial at the time. Essentially, the issuing of imprimaturs is decentralized in the Catholic Church. And what happened was a church somewhere in North America issued this digital imprimatur. The Vatican, it was so controversial, the Vatican itself had to step forward and say, look, while you're allowed to use this app to prepare for confession, please remember this is no substitute for the real thing. So that's just to whet your appetite, I think, and just to ask that question about whether or not white-collar work might be susceptible as well. I'm going to hand over now to hear a little bit more about technology.
Thank you, Daniel. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Technology is at the core of our work. We're trying to think about the ways in which technology is affecting the work of the professions. I'd like to take you back to 1996, when I wrote a book called The Future of Law. And in The Future of Law, I made what now seems a rather unremarkable claim, and that was that the dominant way that lawyers and clients would come to communicate in the future would be by email. At the time, I kid you not, the Law Society of England and Wales said I shouldn't be allowed to speak in public, which is possibly true. They said I didn't understand confidentiality and security. They said in all sincerity that I was bringing the legal profession into disrepute by suggesting that email would become the dominant way the lawyers and clients would communicate. I say this evening because I'm going to be talking about a whole bundle of technologies, and your inclination, many of you as professionals, will be, well, I don't really think that's going to happen in my time or the way they think it's unfolding. I think everything that I claim tonight is more predictable than email was in 1996. The way we look at information technology And we try to find a crisp way of capturing what's going on in the world of technology. We look at it under four headings. We believe that the underpinning technologies are growing at an exponential rate. And the second phrase is fundamental to our thesis. Our systems, ladies and gentlemen, are becoming increasingly capable. They're taking on more and more tasks, many of which we thought in the past would require human intelligence. Not only that, the technologies themselves are becoming increasingly pervasive, whether through our handheld machines or indeed through chips embodied in everyday objects, the so-called Internet of Things. And finally, as human beings, we're becoming, through, for example, social networks, increasingly connected. And what I thought would be useful tonight would be to focus on two of these four factors, exponential growth and increasing capability, to give you a sense of what's happening out there in the world of technology. There is a sense, I find, with many professionals that they're not exposed to the remarkable advances that are being made. So let me start with the exponential growth and start not with the law of the land, but with Moore's law. Gordon Moore was a man who, in 1965, 52 years ago, made what might seem a rather unexceptional claim. He very approximately said that every 2 years, the processing power of computers would double, or its cost would halve, comes to the same thing. Now, that doesn't sound that amazing, but those of you who are mathematicians will know if you keep doubling anything, it gives rise to this explosive, strictly exponential effect. And it's well illustrated by the story of the tramp and the princess. The tramp saves the princess's life, and the king says to the tramp, "By way of reward, I will give you anything in the kingdom." And the tramp, and it turns out this was a mathematically astute tramp, says, "I want something quite simple. I'd like a chessboard. And in the first square of the chessboard, would you please put one grain of rice, and the second double it to two, and the third again to four, and the fourth again to eight, fifth to 16, and so forth. And all I would ask your majesty is that you would give me, by way of reward, all the rice that would appear on the chessboard if you doubled all round the 64 squares. The king thinks he's got it in a way likely. He says, "I grant you that wish," but it transpires that it's not his to grant, because it would require more rice than exists on planet Earth. Because once you double any phenomenon and keep doubling, it goes this shallow start, and then this explosive growth, and that is what's happening to processing power. So that by 2020, for example, the average desktop computer will be able to process at about the speed of 10 to the 16th or 10 to the 17th calculations per second. Now, many neuroscientists will tell you that's about the same processing power as a human brain. Not to say these machines are intelligent, just to give you a sense of how far we've come. In 1973, when I was 12, I held in both hands one of the early pocket calculators. No pocket was big enough, it transpired. But isn't it remarkable that a machine that size, not that many years on, will have the same processing power as the human brain? A great tribute to the human ingenuity and genius of those who've involved in developing computer systems. So it's remarkable, but not nearly as remarkable as this. By 2050, if Moore's law continues, and you should know we've already had 32 or 33 iterations of Moore's law, and material scientists and computer scientists are generally agreed that Moore's law will continue now for many decades yet. By 2050, the average desktop machine will have more processing power than all of humanity put together. Now, this is not science fiction, it's not fanciful, it's not the imaginations of a few eccentrics. This is the maths of doubling every year. And all I can say, and it's a key point, is that we are living, ladies and gentlemen, at a time of greater and more rapid technological progress than humanity has ever witnessed. And it seems to us entirely improbable that this won't at least affect white-collar work. Am I exaggerating? Am I one of these people who's invited along to exaggerate at conferences and seminars and so forth? Well, someone far more eminent than I am said as early as 2001, as Michael Spence, Nobel laureate in economics, he noted at that stage roughly a 10 billion times reduction in the cost of processing power in the first 50 years of the computer age. Now, it comes to the same thing, as I say, doubling every year in processing power, the cost halving. And remember, that's 10 billion times reduction in 2001, so that'll be 20 billion in 2003, 40 billion in 2005, and so forth. And for those of you who want something more prosaic, more everyday, just to illustrate what we're seeing, not just in processing power, but also in storage capacity, reflect on a little memory card that we slip into our cameras. 2005, a good memory card was 128 megabytes. Fast forward not even 10 years to 2014, a good card is 128 gigabytes. That's more than a thousandfold increase in less than 10 years. That's more than a doubling every year. So on almost every technology or underpinning technology you look at, whether it be the amount of data stored, processing power, bandwidth, hard disk capacity, random access memory, we're seeing this explosive growth. And this is fueling the second phenomenon to which we point, the increasing capability of machines. And this, as I say, is fundamental to our thesis, this idea that machines, almost on a daily basis, we hear news of new achievements, new problems solved, new tasks undertaken. And we unpack the idea of increasing capability itself into four categories, which I'll run you through rather rapidly, again, to give a flavor rather than the detail. But I'm wanting to give you some sense of the remarkable times in which we live. The first is this whole notion of big data. You hear a bundle of terms referred to in this context. Some people talk about predictive analytics, others will refer to machine learning, others will talk of data science. But the fundamental and underlying idea here is that as users of the internet and of technology, one of the byproducts is huge amounts of information. Every time we do something as simple as enter some kind of search request in Google, this creates a whole lot of processing and information as a byproduct. Some people call this our data exhaust, the data that flies out behind us as some form of waste product. The interesting thing about this, and it's a relatively recent insight in the mainstream, although one can identify thinking about this in the 80s, but the more recent observation is that this data that we're creating as a byproduct, if analyzed appropriately, can yield insights, patterns, correlations. My favorite example is from my home country of law, and the system Lex Machina, developed by Stanford University, bought by the very large electronic publishers LexisNexis. Lex Machina is a system that can predict the outcome of patent disputes more accurately than any human lawyer. The really interesting thing is it knows nothing about the law. It has about 100,000 records of cases. The name of the judge, the courtroom, the name of the law firm, the name of the lawyer, the name of the client, the subject matter of the claim, the value of the claim, a whole bundle of variables. It turns out that if you have enough data, and if you have clever algorithms, you can actually predict the outcome of a dispute more accurately than engaging the legal method. Now, many lawyers' immediate reaction was, hang on a second, it doesn't understand the law. Of course, that's a problem. But I think we should think about the client for a second. What's the question almost all clients ask when a dispute is coming over the horizon? What are our chances of winning? Now, you may remember Abraham Maslow, the great organizational psychologist, once noticed, he said, if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So if you're a lawyer, everything looks like a legal problem. So this question, what are our chances of winning? What are our chances of winning? The lawyer thinks, well, that is a legal challenge and question. Whereas the computational statistician will say, actually, we can use technology for that. So I have to be very careful, and this is a general message, about why it is that we actually require professionals in the first place. So that's the whole idea of leveraging data. And then, as Daniel mentioned, there's IBM's Watson. It comes in various shapes and sizes, but the version we're very interested in was the system that was designed by IBM to compete on a TV quiz show called Jeopardy. And Jeopardy is a US quiz show, questions about the same degree of difficulty as Mastermind, so hard. And they thought, surely if we could develop a computer system that can make a good account of itself on Jeopardy, then we're demonstrating the power of artificial intelligence. So 2011, in a live episode of Jeopardy, a computer system called Watson beat the two best ever human Jeopardy champions. This is a system answering questions effectively on almost anything in the world more accurately and more rapidly than the most able human beings. And again, IBM are not stopping at quiz shows. They similarly are moving on, and the impact in medicine is already profound, the ability to manage very large amounts of research, the quality of treatment plan, and not long from now, the quality of diagnostics itself, we anticipate will outperform human beings. And then there's another area of technology that's fascinating, and I suspect known to fewer of you, and that's affective computing, machines that can both detect and express human emotions, a machine that can look at your face and tell whether or not you're happy, surprised, angry, or disgusted. There is a system now more accurately than any human being can look at a human smile and tell whether or not that smile is fake or genuine. There's a computer system more accurately than any human being can listen to two female voices and tell whether or not they belong to a mother and a daughter. By the early 20s, due to the moisture and temperature on your hand, your handheld machine will know what kind of mood you're in and will respond accordingly. Your jacket will give you a nice little squeeze when someone sends a friendly message through. We'll be interacting with little robots and chatting to them, certainly with the affection I think we reserve for cuddly toys, perhaps the affection we reserve for pets, and even the affection we reserve for some human beings that we perhaps aren't on particularly close terms with. But we will be interacting with our machines. Our machines, more accurately than us, will be able to detect human emotion, and in response, they will begin to express emotions back to us and engender within us the kinds of feelings we have when interacting with other human beings. And finally, there's robotics. This idea, in 2004, it fascinates us in a book called The New Division of Labor. Two of the world's leading labor economists, in writing about the balance in the future between machines undertaking work and human beings undertaking work, said something like this. They said, in the future, it's hard to imagine a machine undertaking, for example, the task of cutting your hair. It would be hard to imagine a computer system or a machine doing your garden. And thirdly, they said it would be hard to imagine a machine driving a truck. And these are the two leading labor economists commentating on this. And not many years later, we have a fleet of Google self-driving cars. More than that, almost every advanced economy is anticipating by the mid-20s, with profound implications for the workforce, that most driving will actually be undertaken by autonomous vehicles. So there we are, just get to give you a flavor of the first two. But in a sense, the most disconcerting and yet exciting aspect of technology is this. There's no finishing line. No one in Silicon Valley is dusting their hands off and saying, job done, let's call it a day, we've gone far enough. Quite the contrary. The speed of change is actually accelerating. And this takes us to the world of AI, which again is a place of nostalgia for me. In the 80s, I wrote my doctorate in Oxford in artificial intelligence and law. I was one of the early workers in the field. And I think it's helpful to think about that first wave of AI and compare it to what we're seeing today. In 1986, once I'd finished my doctorate, I was approached by one of my former examiners, a man called Professor Philip Capper, who's now a partner in a major law firm. But at the time, he was chairman of the law school in Oxford. And he came to me with this extract from a piece of legislation. Section 2 of this act shall not apply to an action to which this section applies. Now, someone somewhere at some stage presumably thought that was okay as a piece of drafting. But of course, it's unintelligible, as indeed I'm afraid much of our law is to the layperson. And I should say when it says this section, it doesn't actually mean this section, it's referring to another section. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the modern legal system where legislation is drafted, and it really is beyond the reaches, not just of most lay people, but of non-specialist lawyers too. So he said, he's written a book in this new area of law based on this piece of legislation. It's called Latent Damage Act 1986. It's not a great read. The Latent Damage Act 1986 changed the law of limitation, the date after which you can no longer raise an action because too much time has passed. Actions go stale in law. But it turned out this was now incredibly complicated. No one understood it. It affected all the construction and manufacturing industries, affected professions, production industry as well. And he'd written this book, and he said people weren't really following that either. Why didn't we develop a problem solver that could actually reason as he did? And so we developed this system called Latent Damage Law, the expert system. Now, I want to tell you, at the time, this was state-of-the-art graphics. I remember... I know it's embarrassing now, but at the time, the two people shaking hands at the top right-hand corner, we thought was a minor piece of design genius. But anyway, I thought you should see the front screen. But we developed this system, and we actually, it was presented, and this was in the days where floppy disks genuinely were floppy. These are 5 1/4-inch floppy disks, which many of you will probably never have seen, the younger amongst you. And we put these two floppy disks into the back of a book that we wrote on how to develop the system. The system itself was like a huge decision tree, and it had over 2 million paths through it. And in the end, the very interesting thing about this was that this system, as Philip will still say to this day, outperformed him. It was better than him in the end at answering questions in this particular area of law. Reduced research time from hours to minutes. We weren't alone working in this. There was other people working in medicine and tax and audit and consulting. So why, you might ask, did these not take off? Why have we not got lots of problem solvers that answer questions in law? The answer, in a way, is that we will have. I think it's entirely conceivable in the 20s that we'll have many such systems. But at the time, the answer is also interesting. These systems were quite costly to develop. And remember, this was a time when hourly billing was the dominant way of lawyers charging, And why would a law firm want to reduce the amount of time it was spending on legal research if clients weren't, as they weren't at the time, clamoring for reductions in fees and competitors weren't undercutting them? And so there was no economic incentive. But our own thesis, and Daniel and I have thought about this, is that what in effect killed the first wave of AI was the web. The web came along and suddenly there's a more intuitive, cheaper, easier way of making content, advice, documents, materials available online. And most of us working on legal tech and legal AI went over to the legal web. And then something very interesting happened in 97. A computer system, again by IBM, called Deep Blue, beat the world chess champion, Garry Kasparov. Now, in the 1980s, when I was working in the computing laboratory in Oxford, we thought that wouldn't be possible. Never. And the reason we thought it wouldn't be possible is very relevant. Because at that time, we thought the only way you can get a computer system to perform at the level of an expert is by sitting down with an expert, as I did with Philip, mining the jewels from his head, developing a huge decision tree of his reasoning processes, and making it available to other people. The clever thing about the system was not so much the system, it was actually the model, the decision tree, the flowchart we had evolved. One of the problems was, if you spoke to a chess player or a doctor or many other professionals, they said, I can't reduce my reasoning processes to mere rules when it gets difficult. The intuition, the knee-jerk, the genius even, is hard to articulate. It's tacit knowledge. It's almost ineffable. We can't reduce the wonderful performance of our best experts to a mere set of rules. And that was quite a comforting solution. So what computers can do is they can do the routine stuff, following up what Daniel was saying, but the real magic, where the creativity, the imagination is required, that will always require human beings. And that feels intuitively right, but it's wrong. What we hadn't banked on was the exponential increase in processing power. By the time Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov, this was a system that could process more than 330 million moves in 1 second. And a good chess player can only juggle about 100 moves in his or her head at one time. Garry Kasparov was not beaten by a system that was more intelligent or anything like that, a system that had genius or creativity. He was beaten by brute processing power, lots of data, and clever algorithms. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is actually what's going to take much human work away, this combination of processing power, data, and algorithms. But there's a very interesting lesson in all of this, and it's expressed well to us by Patrick Winston when we were writing our book. And in an email, he said to us, he's one of the fathers of AI or academic AI, there are lots of ways of being smart that aren't smart like us. Because many people's intuition was, well, you know, if you're an expert, if you're a professional, you think, and a machine can't think, so how can it ever do, until a machine can think, how can it ever do what I do? So I'm pretty safe. That's the common kind of narrative. And that's committing what Daniel and I call the AI fallacy. And that's the mistaken assumption that the only way to develop systems that perform tasks at the level of experts or higher is to replicate the thinking of human process, the thinking processes of human specialists. This is just not right. What these computer systems do is they outperform us but work in different ways. But you don't understand, Richard, people will say to me. The reason my clients come to me as a lawyer is for my judgment. How on earth can a computer system ever replicate or exercise judgment? And we say that's the wrong question. Here's a better question. Sounds a bit strange, but to what problem is judgment the solution? Why is it that people come to us for our judgment in the first place as lawyers? And the answer to that, invariably, and to many other experts too, is because of uncertainty. People are uncertain about their factual circumstances, they're uncertain about the knowledge that applies. In your experience, in your judgment, what would you advise? So the question is not, ladies and gentlemen, can a computer exercise judgment? It's can a computer handle uncertainty? And all the research we're seeing, the whole field of data analytics and big data suggests of course they can, because machines can handle huge amounts of data, which is one way of controlling uncertainty. So what we're seeing evolving is increasingly capable non-thinking machines. These machines don't need to think like us. They don't need to make judgments like us. They can outperform us, not by copying us. Can machines think? It's a great question. And Daniel and I both trained in philosophy. We like chatting about this question, but for practical purposes, it's irrelevant. John Searle, the philosopher, expressed it well in response to Watson winning that game of Jeopardy. The next day in the Wall Street Journal, he said, Watson doesn't know it won in Jeopardy. Isn't that perfect? Watson didn't want to phone up its mum to celebrate, didn't want to go down to the pub. Watson didn't want to do anything because it didn't have any cognitive states or consciousness or self-awareness. And that is the future of, at least near-term AI. These systems don't need to have any of that to outperform us. And for those of who are doubtful, very quickly, to mention, Daniel alluded to AlphaGo, the system that beat the world Go champion. Just think about game two, move 37. Watch it on YouTube. You'll see the commentators thought it was a mistake when the computer system made the move. World-class players later described it as a beautiful move. I think one even said it brought a tear to his eye. No human being had ever thought of making that move before. In another human being would call that innovative, we call it genius, but I don't think we can use these terms. They're human capacities and facilities. But in a machine, they're certainly coming up things we as human beings haven't thought of before. More than that, the game of Go has been redefined because many human beings are now making that move. So what are the implications of all of this for white-collar work? Over to Dan.
I think one thing to keep in mind in thinking about the future of work is what we do is we tend to talk about the different jobs that people do, and we've both done it. We've both talked about lawyers and doctors and teachers, accountants and so on. And actually the term jobs is very unhelpful. And it's very unhelpful because when you open the bonnet of any professional job and look at what it is that people actually do in a white-collar role, or indeed any role, you'll find that people perform lots of different tasks, lots of different activities. Why does this matter for thinking about the future of work? When we published the book at the end of, first published it at the end of 2015, The Economist reviewed it, and it was a nice review, otherwise I wouldn't have mentioned it. But alongside it was this great cartoon of Professor Dr. Robot QC. And there's a sense when we think in terms of jobs that the way technological change affects work is that one day somebody will turn up at work and find Professor Dr. Robot QC or one of his relatives sitting in their chair. You know, this idea that their job will have been entirely displaced by a robot. That's simply not how technological change affects work. Why is white-collar work going to be affected by technological change? Well, in light of what I've just said, the first is this idea of decomposition. That when we move away from treating any type of job as a monolithic, indivisible lump of stuff, which is what that Professor Dr. Robot QC image encouraged us to do, when we break it up into all the different tasks and activities that people do in the work, it transpires actually that a lot of the work that even white-collar workers do is routine rather than non-routine. That's the first point. Go back to that routine, non-routine distinction right at the start. Actually, a lot of work that professionals do is routine. Not everything requires creativity or judgment or empathy. But then the second point is exactly what we just heard from my dad, and it's the AI fallacy. You know, it's a mistake to think that even those tasks that are non-routine, even those things that might have required creativity, judgment, and empathy when performed by a human being, it's a mistake to think that many of those can't also be automated as well. Just think, and let's just go back to that DeepMind example. The temptation is to say that because a machine can't think, it can't be creative like a human being. But that's, in a sense, true, but DeepMind is performing that task in a very different way. Similarly, the system that designed that concert hall, you know, it's not creative in the way that an architect might be. It's not thinking like a human designer, but it's able to solve the problem in a different way. Empathy, I think, is the one that comes up the most, and this is me and my dad with Paro, the therapeutic seal, which is it's being used increasingly with patients who suffer from various types of illnesses to offer empathy and comfort and support. This furry animal isn't offering empathy. It's not feeling in the way that a human being is, but it's performing that task in a different way. And so these two reasons, I think, is why the future of work, the technology affecting work, isn't just a blue-collar story anymore. First, we're breaking work down into constituent tasks, and many are turning out to be routine. And secondly, in this second wave of artificial intelligence, these increasingly capable, non-thinking machines, we're able to perform more and more of these non-routine tasks as well. And this has implications for individuals, for businesses, and for governments. And I'll hand back to my dad just briefly to go through those.
Yes, indeed. Fundamentally affects, it seems to us, the future for our careers, for our commercial concerns, and for the way we run and organize ourselves. For individuals, our main message, we're often asked by parents, well, what does this mean for our kids? What kind of jobs should they do? And we say, at least for the 20s, it's not going to be the decade of unemployment, it'll be the decade of redeployment. There'll be new work to do, different work to do, but the fundamental thing to think about is this option that seems to us to open up. Do you want to seek to compete with machines or build with machines? Do you say, we hear what Richard and Daniel say, but we still think there's going to be enough jobs or tasks that human beings can undertake that are beyond the capability of machines? Now, we don't disrespect that view, but all the evidence that we've looked at suggests that that slice of the pie is decreasing in size. And so the other option, if you can't effectively compete with the machines, why don't you get involved with building the machines? It's the most exciting decade coming up where we're designing systems to transform our health service, to reinvent the way we offer access to justice, to rethink the way we offer educational services. So there's two ways. You can either think, well, I'll stay traditional and I'll do my best to outperform machines in a very narrow category, or I want to be involved in actually building these new systems. What about businesses? My favorite story in life is about Black & Decker, who when they recruit new executives put up this slide and say, this is what we sell, isn't it? They all agree. Say, that's not what we sell. This is what we sell. And it's very important, I think, when you're thinking of the future of the professions, not to be of power drill mentality, not to think, what do we do and how can we use technology to speed it up? It's to go and ask yourselves fundamentally, what's the value we're bringing? And so it's the point of a judgment, it's the point about lex machina. When the client says, what's the chances of winning? That's the hole in the wall, is a statement of probability, not can you use the legal method, the power drill. And the question's well put, I think, by Levitt, who asked in his article in Harvard Business Review, Marketing Myopia, what business are you really in? That's the question we've got to start asking ourselves as businesses, because so many businesses that we currently run are intimately related to old ways of working. Now that technology can change the way we work, we have to ask some fundamental questions. And he says it so well of railroads. He said the reason the railroad businesses failed is because they thought they were in the railroad industry. In fact, they were in the transportation industry. The competition that kills you doesn't look like you. That's the main message for people in business, because the new competition comes in a different shape or size. And what about governments? Well, we have three questions that are profound. We just raised them today, and they're dealt with to some extent in our book, but they're really, in many ways, the questions of our time. What are we training the young to become? Because in many ways, a lot of our law schools, our medical schools, and all the rest of it, we're actually teaching our people to be good at things that machines are already better at. So just building up bodies of knowledge. And how are we going to retrain the older? If we're right and it's about redeployment rather than unemployment, some people might not be able to retrain, but how are we systematically doing this? How are, as a nation, are we ensuring that our graduates are 21st century graduates and not 20th century graduates? And how are we meeting the inevitable, it seems to us, challenge that in the 20s there'll be less conventional work to do and you have to move away from competing to systems with systems to building the systems? Secondly, who should own and control tomorrow's practical expertise and intellectual property more generally? Practical expertise is our term for the knowledge, the experience, the know-how, and so forth that human experts, white-collar workers, bring to bear in their everyday work. Now, one of the dangers in all of this, and you'll see it yourselves immediately, is that a lot of the online world, whether it be the systems, the technology, the content, or whatever, is actually being owned and controlled by a very small number of corporate organizations. It's not really in the hands of the state. It's not really in the hands of the people. It's actually concentrated in the hands of a very few, and we have some profound questions to ask about whether or not that's desirable or whether or not it's even reversible. And finally, what tasks ought not to be handled by machines? There's a moral issue here. And although we can see machines taking on the cognitive tasks or the problem-solving tasks of human beings, we can see machines taking on the psychomotor manual tasks of human beings, we can see machines even engaging emotionally. What about the morality? What about the idea that as human beings we can recognize what's right or wrong? And we also take responsibility for decisions on the basis of that recognition. Are we happy about the idea of a machine making a decision to turn off a life support system and then actually flicking the switch? Are we happy about a machine articulating a life sentence, passing down a life sentence? We're not particularly, but the public debate here is where we should draw the line. That even if our machines can undertake certain tasks, now is the time for us to think if there is a line to be drawn. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, in many ways the spirit of our work. It's a quotation from Alan Kay, a Silicon Valley chap, who says the best way to predict the future is to invent it. And I think it captures the mood of the moment. I don't think it's the case, or we don't think it's the case, that the future is somehow out there waiting to be discovered. already articulated, and Dan and I do a bit of digging, and we can see slightly clearer than other people. It's not like that at all. It's far more malleable. It seems to us, and we say this to all the professions, that the future is very much within our own hands. And this is why I say to young people coming through, whereas most young doctors, lawyers, accountants, and so forth, just took the baton from the person a couple of years ahead and carried on the great tradition, the coming generation of graduates have the opportunity to reshape the way we look after people's health, the way we reshape the way we administer justice, the way we educate. So two ways in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, looking at all of this. On the one hand, there's a question of the threat perceived to the provider, which I think is undeniable and needs considerable thought. But also on the other hand, the good message is, from the point of view of the recipients, it seems to us our health, our welfare, our happiness will be greatly promoted by these technology. Many thanks. So we've got roving mics. Roving mic all sounds to me like a country and western singer. But the gentleman in the red jumper there. It actually would help if you say who you are and where you come from, so we know your perspective.
I'm Uygar Kılıç. I'm a member of Chatham and consulting startups, tech companies. I would like to ask about the quantum computing and its impact on artificial intelligence. Did you do any research on that area?
Quantum computing is very interesting, and I think people who, and I've been speaking recently to specialists in the area, it's relevant from the question of processing power, and I'm not a specialist, but the rough line of argument here is that many people say Moore's Law is running out because there's only so many transistors you can fit in a silicon chip, and others will say actually what's happening is we're looking at new material science and looking at new materials. Computer scientists are looking at new techniques for the massively parallel machines, and there's an emerging area of quantum computing. I make my Silicon Valley point again. No one in the chip world is saying, let's just call it a day. The commercial imperatives, as well as the sense of competition, is so intense that my own belief is that early signs from quantum computing is that's going to be the heart, maybe not over the next couple of years, but in the 20s, of maybe even greater than a doubling of the processing power. But a lot of the systems we're talking about don't depend on Moore's Law for their success. We've already got lots of processing power. What's more striking in many ways is that there's probably software and systems that will have changed our lives by the 2025 that haven't yet been invented. But quantum will have a role to play, no doubt.
Back corner there in the white shirt.
Yes, we've got
shirt.
To distribute the questions.
Francis Guy, Christian Aid. I have a very different kind of question, if I may. Yes. You haven't said very much about language. And maybe the quantum leaps apply also there, but in trying to use Google Translate across languages that don't use the same letter forms at the moment, it is rubbish. Mm. Are we going to see the same kind of change in that area as well, or is that beyond?
I'm sure you will. I mean, people were saying 10 years ago that machine translation was rubbish, and there's all sorts of stories about systems making all sorts of howlers, out of sight, out of mind, translated as invisible insanity, that kind of thing. These are the standard stories we hear in speech translation. There's a phenomenon we call in the book technological myopia, and that's our apparent, it's collective inability to imagine what the technology might be in a few years' time. I would put any amount of Daniel's money on machines on machines being able to translate even the most dissimilar and complex languages in the future. It's early days. And already, it seems to me, for everyday purposes, certainly between languages that are broadly, structurally, and historically similar, the translation by Google Translate, I think, is a marvel. And we've not got to forget just how amazing all of that is. When I was doing work in AI in the 80s, language translation, natural language translation was a big field, and almost no progress was being made then. It's remarkable how it's been sorted out.
What's particularly interesting is what happened in these technologies that led to the breakthrough, which was that in the 1980s, when your colleagues were working on it, the way we thought you had to go about translating a sentence was to understand how a human being understood, interpreted, and spoke a language, and then try and replicate it. So you had to understand the grammar, you had to understand the context in which the sentence was spoken, and so on. And that very quickly became very complicated, very difficult, and that route dried up. What then happened was and one of the breakthroughs came through the fact that the United Nations publishes a whole set of documents in a vast variety of languages. And using that large amount of data and the available processing power that came about in the 1990s and in the early noughties, it was possible to translate sentences not by understanding how human beings spoke, but instead just through brute force processing power and this huge amount of data. And that shift in performing this task in a very different way to the way a human being does it is what I think is characteristic of many of the technologies.
We were committing the AI fallacy in the 80s, thinking the only way you'll ever be able to translate from one language to another is to do it the way human beings do it, and that's by us understanding context. Same with speech recognition. The noises we make, we thought you couldn't tell the difference between a bomb in a bool and abominable unless you understood the context in which these words were uttered, and that turns out not to be right. We can actually, through again data processing power and algorithms, we speech recognition is phenomenal now. You don't need to think of Siri. 15 years ago, almost unimaginable. A lot of questions. One gentleman down at the front here. If we can have the microphone.
Thank you very much. My name is James Hollis, Caritas Austria. I have a question that's regarding, you touched on it briefly, and that's regarding the education of young people. Yeah. I studied, for example, political science, and I was speaking to someone, actually a lawyer, who also graduated political science, one of the top in his class, and then he went on to study law thereafter. And I asked him, so why did you go off and do law? And he said, because I got to the end of my course, got top marks in the year, and I realized I was completely and utterly useless regarding with respect to what we see in the technological changes that have taken place, that young people aren't getting the skills that are necessary. So do you think that there's a case that there's a real need for a radical overhaul of higher education, that we need to make universities sort of humming hubs for technological innovation and people going and actually getting useful skills which are necessary for the 21st century and the technological changes to come?
There are arguments for that. I wouldn't want, and this is my own view, I think it's terribly important that university is an opportunity also for non-vocational work. I think it's important for people to study philosophy, to read great literature, and to engage in deep intellectual thinking without any particular purpose or end goal. But if we look at our, as I mentioned, our law schools and our medical schools and so forth, they really aren't drastically different from the schools that were in play when I was a student in the 70s and 80s. And I asked the question again, what are we training our young people to become? If you accept, and we didn't in detail go into this today, but we have a new set of roles that we think will be required of the people who will be building the systems that will be sorting out the problems that today's professionals sort out. The question is, are we actually gearing our more vocational courses towards these skills, or are we still inculcating the 20th century skills? And our fear is we're generating 20th century graduates. The point's well made, but I wouldn't want this, as I say, to be a suggestion that university is no longer a place where people are encouraged to engage in critical, complex, philosophical, profound reflection. I know that isn't happen as often as we would want, but I think it's an important period in one's life.
Hi, Hannah Seal, Index Ventures. Hi, Daniel. We were at school together.
It's going to be a friendly question on unemployment.
It's very friendly. So is your view that humanity will find new jobs for people to be able to do like they have in other eras of technological change, like the Industrial Revolution?
Yeah.
Or do you feel like we're going to be kind of left with this huge amount of structural unemployment? And if so, how will people fill their times? What will people do? You know, jobs aren't just about giving people money. They give people purpose and self-worth. And how will people kind of behave in the future? Will we live in a virtual reality where people have virtual jobs just to feel like they have a purpose?
Yeah. It's a really interesting question. My own personal kind of reflection on that is that The immediate problem isn't the story that you read of kind of mass unemployment and large pools of displaced people. That's simply not the case. What we see are, again, the problem is one of redeployment, not unemployment. It's a question of, you know, there are new tasks and activities that exist in the economy, but many people don't have the skills and capabilities that are required to do those tasks and activities. So at least the challenge for the next decade, for the medium term, I think the problem is not one of large pools of displaced people. I mean, the longer term is more troubling, and the you know, what you need to happen, you know, thinking in terms of tasks and activities, one of the criticisms that's often made of people who are pessimistic about the future is the lump of labor fallacy, which is that, look, you don't understand. While it's certainly true that machines are able to do more and more types of tasks and people are able to do less and less types of tasks, clearly the economy grows. So there are more of those tasks that people are being forced into. You know, there are more things that require creativity from a human being and so on. And so what you need in to avoid in the long term structural unemployment or technological unemployment, you not only need lots and lots of new tasks and activities to be created, you not only need the economy to grow a lot, but you also need those tasks and activities to be the sorts of things that people are best placed to do rather than machines. And it strikes us as strange that one of the assumptions is that necessarily the sorts of things that will have to be done in the economy will be the sorts of things that people rather than machines are best placed to do. We have this assumption that necessarily new products and services, new jobs will require the sorts of faculties that human beings uniquely have, rather than the sorts of things that machines might be best placed to do. And it's an interesting assumption. You know, the lump of labor fallacy is to ignore the fact the lump is getting bigger, but it's not clear why it's a lump of labor, why it's a lump of work, certainly, but whether that work is best placed to be done by people rather than machines, it's not immediate. So I think that the longer term is far more ambiguous and far more uncertain. I think just on the question of kind of purpose and meaning and what you do in a world where there's perhaps less work, I think it's a question that people are starting to think about. I think the more pressing question is not the question of purpose or meaning, but instead the kind of economic problem, which is how you support large amounts of people in everyday life. And that's what something like the universal basic income is responding to. I think particular features of that problem, of that solution, I think there's lots of issues, but the nature of the problem that it's responding to, an anxiety that there might not be enough work to do at all, I think that's an interesting and an economic solution to that, how you support people who don't have work. I think that for me is the kind of more pressing problem in the long run rather than the question of meaning and purpose.
The gentleman on the far right. I have this fear, I'm afraid, we're not going to be able to answer all questions, but we will be around for refreshments, and Daniel will be more than happy to.
Thanks. Rommel Johnson, EY. What can you tell us about the dangers that highly advanced AI could potentially pose to humanity over time?
The dangers is interesting because there's been a lot of prominent individuals, specifically Bill Gates, Elon Musk, and Stephen Hawking, who has spoken quite dramatically about AI possibly being the greatest threat to humanity. They're talking there about something called AGI, which is artificial general intelligence. A lot of what we're talking about here are systems that can undertake fairly specialist and well-bounded problem types. The thesis that worries some people is if machines can actually perform more general tasks and have our, in the broadest of senses and subject to everything we're saying about the AI fallacy, but have general intelligence, if they get to our level and they are, as it were, designed as they are designed to self-improve, that it won't be long before they're not just slightly better than us, but they're monstrously superior to us. I think it was Marvin Minsky once said, and he was one of the founders of AI, said that the next generation of machines will be so intelligent, we'll be lucky if they keep us around as household pets. And that's I think, a very interesting book in this context, The Superintelligence, by the Oxford colleague Nick Bostrom, where he looks at the philosophical possibility. He's not saying it's going to happen at a particular time, but it's at least saying it's possible that we could be at the early stages now of generating machines that are wildly superior to us in their intellectual capabilities. And others will say if you combine that with nanotechnology, the ability to manufacture and replicate, then we're moving into a very scary era. I'm not saying I don't share these worries. I almost think the questions are, in technical terms, are too difficult to contemplate at this stage. I think the moral questions we should be considering today, it's very unclear to me how quickly that kind of technology will advance. But it does seem to both of us, and we, in our book, drew a comparison with the work in the early 80s, when some of you will remember the great debate that arose over in vitro fertilization and test tube babies. And it was very clear that a scientific development was in the air that was of profound significance for the future of humanity. And in a rather enlightened way, the government at the time asked Mary Warnock, now Lady Warnock, to undertake, lead a team to look at the ethics of the impact of these new sciences on humanity. We say we need a similar debate just now, and we should be open-minded as to the future of the technology, and at least imagine a scenario that allows that these systems would be greatly superior to us in many respects, and we have to think through what that means for the future of humanity and our role in it. So
I agree with that. I do think though that it's in, because it's such an exciting and interesting idea, it's often quite distracting as well. And I think it has to only be, I think it's important, some people are thinking about it, but it can't distract us from kind of nearer term, medium term problems. I mean, for me, the more pressing question is, in a world of driverless cars, what happens to 3.5 million truck drivers in the United States? Is it realistic to think that we can retrain them? Many of them perhaps reaching the end of their career. What are we retraining them for? How do we do it? Is it possible to do it? And if we can't do it, what do we support them in doing? That question of redeployment, that question of making sure that our labor markets are flexible enough to help people adjust to different tasks, that seems to me, I mean, it's not as exciting, and it clearly has to be part of it. So it's not as exciting, and that exciting story has to be part of what we're thinking about. But I think there are kind of nearer term challenges that we'll face that just really ought to get most of our attention.
From the back,
what do you think, the back of the room?
One more question. From the back of the room.
I don't want you to feel any pressure because it's the last question that needs to be outstanding.
I had a similar question. I'm a population ethicist, and I was, because you mentioned basic income earlier, and a lot of people assume that when a job disappears because a machine has displaced the worker, that the worker is going to get some sort of early retirement, go nicely at home, and just get money coming home, and they're going to have to do nothing and find some meaning in their lives. Do you have any thoughts about fiscally how a large population of displaced people would be supported via basic income or any other scheme if there just aren't jobs to be had for everyone?
Well, I mean, there are the sort of the economics of it are, you know, perhaps politically unpopular, but economics technically, kind of economically possible. The only situation in which large numbers of people are displaced is if you have very productive machines. And somebody owns those machines, and somebody is making a fantastic profit off owning those machines. And so, there are two responses. One is you either, as Bill Gates suggested a few weeks ago, you tax the robots and you tax the owners of the robots. Or alternatively, you think about how you redistribute ownership of those robots. So it's interesting, a company like Uber is owned and controlled by the founders, but then there's a company like Juno, in New York, where half of the ownership in that company is held aside for drivers. The people who own these new technologies, they're not concentrated in the hands of a few people. So the economics of it, the answer is you redistribute, but we know that large redistribution is very difficult. My problem with the universal basic income is less that the kind of the politics of redistribution is difficult. I just don't think it's a very good idea. The idea, I think when many people push it, I think it's elegant and in its simplicity, it's appealing, but I think when you push it, all of a sudden it starts to come apart. And so while I think it's responding to the right problem, I don't think we should attach too much significance to it at the moment.